Queen Elizabeth, the Queen Mother, known affectionately to millions as the Queen Mum. For many, she's the most popular royal figure in recent history.
Well, she was I would call a life enhancer. You know, she'd walk into the room and light it up.
I thought she had a delight in life, delight in people and things. I think it's a great gift, and she's on my list of originals.
Born a commoner, she married a prince, but she never expected or wanted to become queen.
She had no choice in the matter. She just jolly well had to be. She didn't want to be one little bit.
When the abdication happened and her shy and stammering husband was forced to be king, she had to step up to the mark.
She would deeply resent it if I said to you that she was the power behind the throne, but that's exactly what she was.
In 1952, crisis hit again when her husband George VI died unexpectedly. She was grief-stricken, and many thought she would never recover.
His death was absolutely devastating for her, because she lost not only her husband, but she lost her position.
There had to be a change when her daughter became queen. Suddenly, the curtsies went the other way around.
But Elizabeth was made of tough stuff.
There was a very strong person within the Queen Mother. Cecil Beaton did describe her as a marshmallow made on a welding machine, as he put it.
This is the story of the real Queen Mother after her husband died. A woman of immense charm and determination who sank to the depths of despair, but fought her way back to become Queen Elizabeth, the Queen Mother. Early in 1952, the King and Queen arrived at London Airport to wave off their daughter, Princess Elizabeth, and Prince Philip. They were setting off on a tour of Kenya. The King looked haggard and worn. He'd just undergone an operation to remove his left lung, but his cancer was terminal, a fact the doctors had kept from him.
There's a wistfulness about George VI as he says goodbye to his daughter. With hindsight, one feels he must have known something or sensed something. After all, he'd been through a ghastly physical ordeal. We know he wasn't sleeping well, coughing all the time. There's some poignancy there. There's some knowledge, I think, in his eyes.
The Queen was more optimistic. Only a couple of months before, she'd assured the public her husband was on the mend.
I'm very grateful indeed for your welcome and for your kind reference to the King. I'm glad to say that he continues to make most excellent progress.
It was typical of her refusal to face unwelcome facts. On the morning of February the 5th, 1952, the King felt well enough to go shooting on his Sandringham estate, a favourite sport since his youth. But it would be for the very last time.
It was announced from Sandringham at 10:45 today, February the 6th, 1952, that the King, who retired to rest last night in his usual health, passed peacefully away in his sleep. Earlier this morning,
Queen Elizabeth was stunned by the death of her husband. Of course, she knew that he'd had operations, she knew that the doctors had written all these reports which didn't look good. But she obviously wasn't expecting him to die so suddenly, in his sleep.
Elizabeth was completely distraught. Just hours after his death, she broke the news to George's mother, Queen Mary. I flew to his room and thought he was in a deep sleep. He looked so peaceful, and then I realised what had happened. After months of denial, reality hit hard for the Queen. Last night, he was in wonderful form and looking so well. He was my whole life. It's almost more than one can bear. But alongside her grief, there was a bitterness about the abdication which had forced her husband onto the throne.
She blamed Edward VIII, his elder brother, for her husband's premature death, the burden of the monarchy being thrown on him shortened his life.
She was angry about that and bitter about that, and just absolutely lost, because she lost not only her husband, but she lost her position.
They were a devoted couple, and suddenly he was gone. And because of who they were, I mean, her whole life changed overnight. She was the queen, and then she suddenly wasn't the queen any longer. Her daughter was. And she had to take a completely different role.
Elizabeth was about to enter the toughest period of her life. It would take all her strength to come back from the depths of grief, and some feared she would never get over it.
The passing of King George VI came as a sudden and most grievous shock to his people all over the world.
The public, like Queen Elizabeth, had been kept in the dark about the king's cancer, so they too were left reeling from the news of his sudden death.
We all believed that his health had been improving, a fact that added weight to the blow when it fell.
Well, it was awful. We all found out about, really, the connection between smoking and lung cancer through the death of the king.
I was a little boy of 7, and I remember the sense of shock. And these black-bordered newspapers and a sense of national gloom, and my parents who'd lived through the war and remembered what the king stood for him to go. It was a sense of a real national blow.
The king's friend and speech therapist, Lionel Logue, was also deeply shocked. He'd treated George VI for years and had formed a close bond with him.
My grandfather remained friends with the king throughout his life, and so devastated to hear of the king's passing, my grandfather writes to the Queen Elizabeth, "There arrived a most wonderful letter from His Majesty on December 16th, telling me all about his health and what he'd gone through. The king's letter is in front of me as I write, and I cannot realise that it is the last one I shall ever receive. Since 1926, he honoured me by allowing me to help him with his speech. And no man ever worked as hard as he did and achieved such a grand result. During all those years, you were a tower of strength to him, and he has often told me how much he owed to you, and the excellent result could never have been achieved if it had not been for your help." And she writes back to him shortly after that, on this black-rimmed paper, "My dear Logue, I'm so grateful for your very kind letter and very touched by what you write. I shall always be deeply grateful to you for all you did for him. He was such a splendid person, and I don't believe that he ever thought of himself at all. I did so hope that he might have been allowed a few years of comparative peace after the many anguished years he's had to battle through so bravely, but it was not to be. And with, again, my heartfelt thanks, I am yours very sincerely, Elizabeth."
Now the king had died, it would be the last time Elizabeth could sign her letters as a reigning queen.
One reign has ended, a reign begins. Her tour cut short by the tragic passing of her father, Princess Elizabeth leaves the Argonaut.
The day after she returned to London Airport, the 25-year-old Princess Elizabeth was proclaimed the new queen.
"With one voice and consent of tongue and heart, publish and proclaim that the high and mighty Princess Elizabeth is now Queen Elizabeth II.
4 days later, George VI's body was carried by train from Sandringham to London for his funeral. Travelling with him was his grieving widow.
In a family so united as the royal family, it's easy to understand how desperately the king will be missed. And, of course, his loss must be felt in an especially tragic degree by his widowed queen.
For nearly 20 years, Elizabeth had devoted every minute of her waking life to bolstering her husband. She'd seen him through the abdication and the war. Now it seemed everything was gone.
She was 51 years old, absolutely in the prime of her life, and suddenly everything that she had fought for and worked towards and created out of this mess after the abdication was suddenly taken away from her.
it's impossible to know how any widow feels at the death of her husband. But I think what's very tough is that the moment a sovereign dies, all attention, quite rightly, goes to the new monarch. And suddenly her daughter was queen. And everyone went to the queen for advice. Everyone went to the queen to ask what was required. And I think that this sort of double hit of losing the man you love and seeing the role that you have supported him in disappear in a one-er must have added to the impact of grief.
The king is laid to rest, and the majesty of death ends with a family beginning its life anew. A young queen takes over the burden of monarchy.
In the past, royal widows had retired gracefully behind the neck curtains at Windsor to a quiet life in the shadows. But not Elizabeth.
She didn't take it lying down. She didn't simply hand over to her daughter and step gracefully into the background. She did make it known that she wanted to still be of use.
Just 3 days after the funeral, Elizabeth issued an extraordinary press statement. She told the public she was now to be known as Queen Elizabeth, the Queen Mother. This was not just a way of distinguishing herself from her daughter. It was a way of telling the world she was going to be the first ever working Queen Mother. Throughout our married life, she wrote, we have tried, the King and I, to fulfill with all our hearts and all our strength the great task of service that was laid upon us. My only wish now is that I may be allowed to continue the work we sought to do together.
The emotional trauma of losing a husband, combined with the fact that she was now in this very secondary position, she might have been sidelined altogether, which was why I think she wanted not to give up. And she was very young, and after all, I mean, she was only, in effect, halfway through her life, as it turned out. So I think, psychologically speaking, she was building a role for herself.
Just 4 months after her husband's death, the Queen Mother travelled north. It was her first day back at work in Scotland, land of her birth.
Visiting the 1st Battalion, the Black Watch, at Crail Camp, Fife, the Queen Mother, as Colonel-in-Chief of the regiment, posed for souvenir photographs, and she inspected the battalion, which was about to leave for service in Korea.
I think it's very significant that one of the first duties she performed after the King's death, when she must have been feeling really like hiding away, and yet duty called her out, and she goes to see the Black Watch going off to battle.
The Black Watch, so dear to my heart, and to many of my family who have served with the regiment, has for more than 200 years played a distinguished part in the battles of our country.
This, after all, is the regiment that saw the sacrifice of her own brother. And in the loss of her husband, I think she was at one with those soldiers in the fight they faced.
I remember well getting ready for it. We were all frightfully pleased that the Queen Mother was going to come and see us. I think she was very keen on doing a proper job, and the proper job was to boost our morale. Certainly the press and people said, you know, it was absolutely marvellous that so soon after he died, she would undertake this job. I have here, this is my sort of family photo album, and I was here, on the left here. We were all then sat down with her to have our photographs taken. There she is, dressed in that mourning black coat, black hat, black shoes. And we had armbands on, which we had to wear because the king had died, and I kept them in my case from that very day. And here it is. I can put it on or try and put it on. These mourning bands and the patches or black ties and so on were a matter of respect of us to her husband.
Elizabeth had always been driven by a strong sense of duty, but behind her calm, smiling public exterior, she was still a grieving widow.
I remember saying to her, does it get better? And she said, no, no, it doesn't ever get better, but you get better at it, which was a wonderful way of putting it. And I think she missed the king till the day she died. She really did.
I feel engulfed by great black clouds of unhappiness and misery, she wrote to a friend at the time. Such sorrow is such a strange experience. It really changes one's whole life. After leaving the Black Watch, Elizabeth retreated even further to the very north of Scotland. She'd gone there to find some peace at the home of her close friends, the Viners. And while up there, she happened to spot the refuge she so desperately needed to rebuild her life.
One day, she was driving down the road towards John O'Groats with the Viners, and she said, oh, look at that, some trees. What's going on over there? And they said, oh, that's a ruined old castle. She said, oh, dude, let's go and have a look. So they drove down the drive, and there was the castle looking rather sad because it was in a pretty derelict state. And she said, ah, I'm going to buy it and save it for Scotland. Members of her household thought, oh, you know, it's a widow's folly, and, you know, she's still distraught with grief at the loss of the king. And she's, you know, she's done this on the spur of the moment, and it won't last long, and how wrong they were.
The Queen Mother immediately wrote to her treasurer, Arthur Penn, to get his approval for her new purchase.
My dear Arthur, when I was staying up in Caithness, I passed a dear little castle down by the sea. And when I visited, I discovered that it was going to be sold for nothing, just the value of the lead on the roof. This seemed so sad that I thought I would buy it and escape there occasionally when life became hideous. The air is lovely and one looks at Orkney from the drawing room. The only sad thing is that part of the roof was blown off in the great gale last January, and I shall have to put in electric light, of course. Do you think me mad? I think he did think she was a little mad, but that's what she wanted and that's what she did. She just fell for the place. It is magic. I mean, it sits on the cliff looking out to sea and it is lovely.
She loved to go down onto the beach and collect shells. She loved the big skies and the wide open spaces. And I think after the king's death, the Queen Mother was maybe looking for somewhere quiet to grieve. It's very difficult for members of the royal family to display their grief because they are so much in the public eye. But I think she found a great peace in Caithness.
Clearly in her despondency following the death of her husband, the idea of being a grieving widow lost in the wilds of Scotland appealed to her. After all, she came from up there, and the poetry of it, the romance of it, the escapism of it, all attracted her.
But press reports about the Queen Mother's new Scottish retreat set alarm bells ringing back in London. Winston Churchill, the Prime Minister, who was an old friend and ally, was particularly alarmed. He wanted her back at court, not just for her own good, but for his too. So in the late autumn of 1952, some 8 months after the King's death, he hurried up to Scotland to lure her back to London.
We don't know what he said to her, but we do know that whatever it was, that he clearly made her know that there was a role for her and that she should be coming out of retirement, which she had briefly gone into, and that she should take part in national life.
But the Queen Mother's return to London wouldn't be welcomed by everyone. The Queen Mother and Prince Philip hadn't always seen eye to eye, and now the battle lines between them would be drawn. A battle between the old and the new. But who would come out on top was anyone's guess.
We all know that utopia is unobtainable. But if we know the world that we want, then at least we can work for it.
Philip was actually quite a progressive person. He wanted to change things. He wanted to get rid of some of the old-fashioned flummery. He wanted to introduce a system where you didn't have footmen with silver platters taking notes from one room to another in Buckingham Palace, from one member of the family to another. He thought that it might be rather more sophisticated to have a telephone system. Whereas she, Queen Elizabeth, the Queen Mother, was wedded, absolutely wedded, to the traditions of the past. So they really stood for two opposed views of what the monarchy ought to be about, the utterly dyed-in-the-wool traditionalist one and the progressive one.
The new queen found herself caught in the crossfire between these two powerful characters, each intent on making her see things their way. From an early age, she proved she was committed to her royal duties.
Yes.
But the question now was whose advice would the new queen choose to listen to? Her modern-minded husband or her tradition-loving mother who saw herself as the guardian of the royal flame?
There's no doubt that Queen Elizabeth, the Queen Mother, was a strong character. And when her daughter Elizabeth came to the throne, aged 26, 25, she was ill-prepared. And I think at that time, Elizabeth was slightly cowed by the whole enormity of what had happened. I think she relied very heavily on Sir Alan Lascelles, her private secretary, and the Prime Minister, Winston Churchill. And I think she listened to these people and to her mother. And she did what they told her. And Philip, I think, found that very hard. And there was friction, I think, between Philip and his mother-in-law, quite rightly.
In early May 1953, Churchill told the Queen something she didn't want to hear. And what he said infuriated both her mother and her husband. Since their marriage, Elizabeth and Philip had lived happily at Clarence House. They didn't want to move. But Churchill, a stickler for protocol, insisted they had to live in Buckingham Palace. But its current resident wouldn't budge. She loved being at the Royal HQ, where she had the ear of her daughter.
The Queen Mother was desperate to stay in Buckingham Palace. She wrote impassioned letters to her daughter, saying, look, I won't be a nuisance at all. I'll just be up in my own flat. I won't intrude on you. It'll be absolutely fine. And Prince Philip was really intent on removing the mother-in-law from the nest. It was as simple as that. Actually, he didn't want to move into Buckingham Palace himself. He wanted to stay in Clarence House. However, when Churchill said, you've got to live over the shop, he didn't want to live over the shop with his mother-in-law, with whom he didn't get on and who didn't get on with him.
In mid-May, the Queen Mother reluctantly moved into Clarence House, which she called small and horrid, despite being one of the largest private houses in London. After 15 years of holding court at Buckingham Palace, she might well have felt she was coming down in the world. But this steely widow wasn't going to be sidelined for long. She would soon find a way of regaining some of the power and influence she'd enjoyed as Queen. And there was nothing Prince Philip would be able to do to stop her. In June 1953, just over a year after her father's death, the new queen's coronation took place. At the insistence of Prince Philip, the coronation was televised. Both Churchill and the Queen Mother had been dead against this. They were sure that the cameras and lights would ruin the intimacy of the sacred ceremony. But unusually, the new queen backed her husband. And in the end, over 20 million people tuned in to watch. The Queen Mother was captured by the cameras, standing with a protective arm around the four-year-old Prince Charles. It was a sign of the new role she was making for herself, one that would make her a key influence on the upbringing of the future heir. Immediately after the coronation, the royal family gathered at Buckingham Palace to have their photos taken by the Queen Mother's favourite photographer, Cecil Beaton.
When Beaton received the telephone call inviting him to be the official photographer for the Queen's coronation, he knew straight away that the Queen Mother was instrumental in that selection process. And I think for Beaton, the Queen Mother was really a reassuring and calming presence there. And we see her here as the central figure in numerous group portraits, flanked by pages and with her daughter, Princess Margaret, here with her grandson, Prince Charles. And Beaton writes beautifully about this moment in his diary, that Prince Charles and his sister, Princess Anne, were running around, hugely overexcited on the coronation day. And it's the Queen Mother who pins them down. She leans over and kisses her grandson and makes a perfect shot for Beaton. But this picture, I think, really encapsulates that quotation from Beaton's diary about the Queen Mother as the great mother figure and nanny to us all.
The Queen Mother's relationship with all her grandchildren was warm, but she had a special bond with Prince Charles.
I think that the Queen Mother saw in Prince Charles somebody that needed the same sort of support that she'd given to George VI, a man who was probably rather insecure in some ways, especially when he was very little, and possibly even a little bit lost. Courtiers would tell you that she always had great respect for the important position that he was one day going to have. But I think it was much more that, you know, it was just a sort of wonderful natural friendship across the generations.
Prince Charles obviously found with the Queen Mother the softness that he didn't get either from his own mother or from Prince Philip. And we know this from his authorised biography, that he found his mother and his parenting distant. And I think he got from his grandmother the warmth that his parents never gave him, or that he felt, certainly, that they never gave him.
The Queen was a slightly standoffish mother. There wasn't a real mother-son bond, I don't think. And really her focus, I think, was on the monarchy, on doing the job that fate had decreed she must do.
It was indeed a dramatic scene, this departure on a cold November night. Historic too, for never before has a sovereign flown the Atlantic on a round-the-world tour to visit subjects in the Commonwealth.
In November 1953, Prince Charles's bond with his grandmother was boosted when his parents embarked on a five-month world tour. The Queen Mother was left in charge of Charles and Anne. It was the first of many times when the Queen, as a working mother, would entrust her children's care to their grandmother.
All Britain wishes Her Majesty and the Duke bon voyage. We shall certainly miss them here at home.
The Queen Mother had now been a widow for little over a year, but she'd picked herself up and was forging a new life for herself. Alongside caring for her grandchildren, her role as grandmother to the nation now really took off. Thanks to some lobbying by her old ally Churchill, a crucial law had been overturned that November. It meant the Queen Mother could replace her daughter on official duties when the Queen was out of the country.
What a tremendously busy year it's going to be for all members of the royal family. And how pleasant to see the Queen Mother so graciously taking her part in public functions again.
And it wasn't just at home. Soon the Queen Mother had managed to extend her role to foreign trips, and she was quite clearly relishing the power and acclaim she'd once enjoyed as Queen.
Over 1,000 guests were present for this, the most glittering social event of the Canberra visit. The Queen Mother, seemingly tireless in the fulfilment of each and every programme, now took the floor.
Put yourself in a position of suddenly finding yourself Queen Mother with most of your more serious responsibilities removed. Nowhere would not be honoured by your presence. I think that the Queen Mother genuinely had a very good time.
She did a great many engagements, and she was that marvellous sight in her feathery hats and her pastel colours, and just always smiling, always, always smiling and cheering people up.
Her eyes would sort of surf a crowd, and also when she was meeting a lineup of people, she had a habit of sort of meeting one man and moving on to the next and sort of pausing and sort of looking back at the first man as if to say, really, would have much rather stayed and talked to you, but needs must. I mean, she was very, very proficient at all those things. There's a certain thespian quality involved, but why not?
the naturalness with which she could reach out, talk to people, empathize. There's something very theatrical about it. In many ways, the Queen Mother deplored the age of celebrity, but she was a celebrity and she knew how to act up to it and she loved it. She played the part.
She was the greatest actress that the royal family had in the 20th century, without a doubt. She knew exactly how to go down a flight of steps. She knew exactly when to turn. She also had this ability, if anything didn't meet with her approval, I've seen her do it on occasion when she came to the V&A, she would bypass it and then go in another direction.
The Queen Mother was never good at facing unpleasant facts, from her husband's illness to her family's feuds. Her friends called it ostriching. But in 1955, a problem arose that she couldn't ignore, and it would cast a shadow over the rest of her long life: divorce. The press had been discreet until then, but now they broke the story of Princess Margaret's love affair with divorcee Peter Townsend. It was the first of many royal marital crises that dogged Elizabeth's later years.
Pressmen and sightseers throng the lanes, undeterred by the official statement that no announcement is contemplated at present about the princess's future.
The Queen Mother had known about her daughter's affair and, in character, had turned a blind eye. But when the story broke, she had to act fast to stop the unthinkable, her daughter marrying a divorced man.
Times have changed now, but I think at the time, I mean, people forget that if you were divorced, you weren't allowed into the royal enclosure at Ascot, for instance. And if you worked in the royal household and you got divorced, you probably wouldn't stay there.
For the Queen Mother, the problem went much deeper than social disgrace. It was a stark reminder of a very painful time.
The reason why the Queen Mother found the Princess Margaret, Peter Townsend relationship so difficult to cope with was because divorce had played such a critical part in the abdication crisis, which had nearly brought down the monarchy. And remember that, you know, the abdication was less than 20 years ago at this time. She was frightened that divorce, again, would create major problems.
It was because of Elizabeth's brother-in-law Edward's decision to marry an American divorcee, Wallace Simpson, that caused the abdication, that caused all the heartache that she and George VI endured during his reign. And she could only see harm coming from it.
The Queen Mother, I think, felt that the ghost of the abdication crisis was still walking, and it was walking right into Princess Margaret's bedroom. So she felt that at all costs this sort of thing had got to be stopped, because what had undermined the monarchy very seriously in 1936 could undermine it in 1956. So she conspired with the powers that be to prevent the marriage from happening.
A decision not to marry Group Captain Peter Townsend is reached by Princess Margaret, here arriving with her mother for a formal family appearance at London's Royal Opera House. In putting duty and religion ahead of her heart, Queen Mother Elizabeth approved her daughter's decision. Strongly opposing the marriage was the Archbishop of Canterbury.
Margaret eventually agreed to give up Townsend under pressure from her mother. It was a decision which she later said ruined her life.
The war hero whose divorce prevented the marriage returns to duty in Belgium.
By urging her daughter to give up the man she loved for the sake of the crown, the Queen Mother had shown her steely side. Cecil Beaton may have called her the great mother figure and nanny to us all, but he also famously described her as a marshmallow made on a welding machine.
Well, yes, well, Cecil Beaton did describe her as a marshmallow made on a welding machine, as he put it. There was a very strong person within the Queen Mother. I think to some extent that's why sometimes her face was so animated and her eyes danced, because if they didn't, they could look quite severe, actually.
Oh, I think the inner core of the woman was absolutely resolute. And underneath the softness and the flirtatiousness to a degree and the sense of humour and the warmth. I mean, when push came to shove, she would have a very
firm idea of the role of the monarchy and the rest of it. To her, the monarchy was sacred.
Princess Margaret never forgave her mother for insisting she put duty before her own happiness. Now, with her hopes of marriage to Townsend dashed, she was forced to settle back to a strained life with her mother at Clarence House.
One never gets a sense of great chumminess about mother and daughter living together there. They didn't do things together. They lived separately. And from what one reads and hears, as the years went by, they became more and more separate. I mean, there are stories, I don't know if they're true, of the two women sitting down at either end of a table and having dinner and not exchanging a single word because, for various reasons, they each was furious with the other.
The Queen Mother's clash with Margaret was the last major battle she fought to protect the type of traditional monarchy she believed in. In the coming years, divorce, beginning with Margaret's failed marriage to Lord Snowdon, would rip through the royal family. Half the Queen Mother's children and grandchildren's marriages would end in failure. It was a reflection of the changes sweeping through the country. Now the Queen Mother decided it was time to take a step back. But how would she cope being out of the royal limelight? Britain in the 60s was changing fast, and the royal family needed to keep up. But standing firm against the tide of change was the Queen Mother. In the year following the King's death, she'd successfully forged a role for herself as the first working Queen Mother. But now, as old age approached, she withdrew from the front line of the family business. It was time for a more leisurely lifestyle, one that harked back to happier times.
When I first went to Clarence House and the Castle of May to talk about books and articles that I wanted to write, there was a wonderful sense of going back in time. There she was, unashamedly remembering when Britain had an empire on which the sun never set, charming, aristocratic, frankly snobbish, no pretense of actually living in the late 20th century, nostalgic for a past world. It's the style that television has merchandised into Downton Abbey, upstairs, downstairs.
The Queen Mother might have turned her back on the hurly-burly of the modern world, but she by no means became a recluse. She loved nothing more than to entertain guests in her homes in England and Scotland.
She was an extraordinarily gregarious person and didn't really like being on her own very much. And places like the Castle of May, there were sort of regular teams of guests arriving to stay for sort of 4 or 5 days at a stretch. And there were barely any respite. So if you were on duty, as I was as a young equerry, starting when she went up to the Castle of May, normally on the 7th or 8th of August, it was pretty exhausting work. There were wall-to-wall guests of various ages, but she was a terrific hostess, and she did like her food very much and used to scrutinise the menus every day, would talk to the chef about what they were going to have to eat, and he'd come up with suggestions, and always the menus were written out in French and put on the tables.
The Queen Mother's style of entertaining may have been old-fashioned, with servers galore and umpteen courses, but her dinners were always great fun.
She had a wonderful expression for drink. It was called liquid refreshment. It was always, is it the witching hour, which was about 12 o'clock?
There was a naughty and mischievous side to the Queen Mother that came out more in her widowhood. She was a merry widow, never made any secret of her fondness for gin and Dubonnet.
My father-in-law used to give an annual lunch in her honour, and I was looking after the drinks. And I was told all the Queen Mama liked was, a socking great gin and a tiny little touch of Dubonnet on the top. So I gave her a whopper and then went and looked after everybody else. And then I thought, hooray, now at last it's time I can get one for myself. But looked at the Queen's and it was empty. So I said, oh, ma'am, can I get one? Oh, well, perhaps a little more. So delicious, don't you think? And so I put another enormous beaker full.
The Queen Mother's tastes were traditional and her politics remained conservative. but she had a wide and varied social circle.
Well, the record is clear. The Queen Mother loved artistic folk, theatrical folk. The sensibilities of a Cecil Beaton, of a Noel Coward, of a Roy Strong, waspish, but not too vicious, funny social commentators.
The first time I ever met her informally was when Beaton asked me to lunch, and he was on the phone. He said, "Oh, Roy, Queen Mother always meets the same old boring people, so I'm asking you."
Queen Elizabeth rather tended to divide her friends into the sporties and the arties, and I came in the latter category. Since I had a lot of friends among the sporties, I was always rather longing to go on a sporty weekend, but was never asked of one. But the art weekends were very good fun. There was lots of actors and people who could play the piano she loved, because she liked a sing-song after dinner. And she particularly liked Cole Porter. She was always interested, great fun. And what she liked was to be amused and to amuse people.
There is something marvellous about Queen Elizabeth, always utterly unflustered and a true merry widow. Crisis seemed not to affect her. Warmth of friendship flows freely, together with an intense interest in everyone, in what they are doing. That was a wonderful quality. Every day to her was an adventure. I think it's a lovely attribute. She would open her eyes, everything around her was an adventure. Okay, she had something of shutting out what didn't fit in with her scheme of things. But I never remember her being ever down with something. There was always something. And somehow she could make even the boring incident fascinating. And she just had this natural curiosity about things. I think it's a great gift, and she's on my list of originals, which isn't very long.
The Queen Mother's life spanned the whole of the 20th century. She witnessed huge challenges to her ideal of monarchy. Most shocking for her was the very public collapse of her favourite grandson Charles's marriage. But throughout, she continued to present a dignified and reassuringly cheery appearance in public. It was all part of a successful formula she'd forged in the first few years following her husband's death, and one that ensured she remained, till the end, the nation's favourite grandmother.
I think she was loved to the very, very end, quite simply because she carried on carrying on. Duty was her life. Duty, but fun and gaiety, and she carried on putting on those lovely feathery hats and the lovely pastel flowing coats and dresses she wore, and smiling and doing what people wanted her to do.
If you are a monarchist, you can only rejoice in her existence, the Queen Mother, but she was a tremendous popularizer. I think she probably did more than any other individual to put the royal family at the center of people's consciousness and to make them feel that we were all one family.
Well, she was I would call a life enhancer. You know, she'd walk into the room and light it up, and everybody felt the better for her being there. Magic she was, in a way.